The friend of a missing Indiana college student tells police he has memory loss from the night she disappeared. Lauren Spierer was last seen June 3rd after a night out with friends. Now a new report reveals 2 hours before she vanished, Spierer helped a male friend get home after he'd been in a scuffle. And that friend now claims he was punched in the face and has no memory of how the night ended. Well, meanwhile, police and Spierer's mother are pleading with the public to call in with any information they might have.
I think that we were all very hopeful that there would be that one nugget of information or that one phone call that would come in that would lead us to Lauren. And at this point, that phone call has not been received, but we are still encouraged.
In relationship to that, the person that knows this person that's not coming forward with the information, I beg you to come forward.
Well, joining us now is Fox News contributor Rod Wheeler, a former D.C. homicide investigator. Thanks for being with us, Rod.
Good morning,
Patty. A quick check of the timeline. Thursday night, she goes to Kilroy Sports Bar. 2:30 in the morning, she leaves with Corey Rossman. 10 minutes later, arrives at her apartment building with him. There's a scuffle caught on tape between Corey and another man in that lobby. And so Corey and Lauren left, never went up to her apartment. They go to Corey's building nearby. They visit multiple apartments in that building. At about 4:30, Corey's roommate, Mike Beth, says Corey goes to bed, Lauren leaves. She's last seen walking barefoot on the street 3 blocks from her apartment. Surveillance video does not show her arriving at her own building. Her keys, her coin purse found in an alley on the way home. Obviously something happened during that walk home. Foul play, do you believe?
I believe it was foul play, but I can tell you that the police are operating right now off of 3 theories real quickly here, Patty Ann. One, you know, is Lauren's disappearance the result of the altercation that took place that you just talked about with these other individuals? The police have not ruled that out completely yet. They have identified 10 persons of interest that were involved in that, but so far none of these people have panned out. The second theory that they're working off of is maybe Lauren was the victim of some sexual predator in that community. Now, there's well over 140 sexual predators living in that community there in Bloomington, so they are checking that out. As a matter of fact, I just read where the U.S. Marshals Service has gotten involved in this case, and they're looking at these sexual predators. And then the third theory, real quickly, is whether or not Lauren just could have walked away, maybe harmed herself, and she could be somewhere waiting on help to come. So one of those theories I think the police are going to really, really zero in on this week.
Yeah, Corey Rossman, this person who she was walking back and forth with, has hired a lawyer immediately.
Right.
And the lawyer says that when Corey and Lauren arrived at that building, that there was that fight, Corey was punched in the face. And the lawyer claims that now Corey has no memory of anything else that happened that night. Fishy?
You know, we call that convenient amnesia in law enforcement. You know, why is it? Here's my question, Patty Ann. Why did this guy run out so quickly and lawyer up? Typically, as a homicide investigator or any investigator, when a person runs out quickly right after somebody is missing or harmed and get an attorney, we always look at that person with some air of suspicion because that's a little bit unusual. Now, that doesn't necessarily in and of itself mean that Corey was involved, but it does raise the level of suspicion with him. And then why is it that he cannot remember something that just happened days ago?
Yeah, police are not giving details on who is or is not cooperating, but they do say, as you mentioned, there are 10 persons of interest. They say one of them is Corey. One of them is Corey's roommate, Mike Beth.
Right.
Another one is this other person who says he saw her leave the building. Also, she has a boyfriend, Jesse Wolf, who
That's
she
right.
apparently was not with that night. They say that some of these people have not agreed yet to be interviewed by police and that police cannot compel them to come in and cooperate at this point.
You know, Patty Ann, I find that to be the most interesting aspect so far of this case. Let me tell you why real quickly. The police chief made a statement yesterday, and I thought this was so interesting. He said to the people there that we cannot compel people to stay in town. If they want to leave town, they have the right to leave town. I'm thinking to myself, why did he make that statement? It's almost like he's saying there is someone or maybe a couple of people who have left the area. They have not cooperated. They have used the polygraph exam on certain people. But so far, like I said, that has not panned out.
Yeah. Meanwhile, you've got the Texas Equisearch talking about getting involved, and they say they're hoping for a miracle, but in their own words, it doesn't look good at this point. One of the focuses was this Lake Monroe nearby.
That's right.
Police
yep.
apparently got some kind of, they call, very specific tip, but so far that hasn't panned out. How does that play into this?
Well, I can tell you that they got so far about 40 tips. I don't know if you know, but America's Most Wanted ran a segment Saturday night on this. And as a result of that segment, they got 40 tips in. You know, the normal course for an investigation like this is to check every tip out, see if it pans out. So far, nothing has panned out. But any information the police can get right now is definitely going to be helpful. So if any of our viewers know anything about what could have happened to Lauren, they really need to give the cops a call there in Bloomington.